about to surrender the whole Philippines.
Only Corregidor. Corregidor lang.
But the Japanese, that Homa, was very adamant, you know. And he said, if we don't surrender all the troops in Manila, we will annihilate all the surrendered troops in Corregidor. Mm-hmm. We were already helpless. And so General Wainwright, Jonathan Wainwright, mm-hmm. was forced to surrender the whole. But actually, the American commanders and Filipino commanders of the USAFE could sense that he was only forced to do it. So all over, they continued the struggle in Visayas and in Danau, especially using
the
guerrilla.
Is this the march? This is not the popular death march, is it? Wala, no? Hindi naman to. These are the proud Americans walking away and the proud Filipino soldiers who have been given up.
The death march, I think that's a death
march.
This
is the death march already, the start.
Actually, from the 100,000 soldiers, we lost around 30,000 during that time. And another half of it perished in the infamous Camp O'Donnell.
Yes, okay. Oh my God.
According to historians, there were more people
Capas nito.
Who were killed, who died in the Capas concentration camp than in Germany, than in those concentration camps in...
Really? Yeah. That comparison?
That was an American historian, where historian said it. He had the data about it.
Gee, look at this. Now you'll see, well, this is devastation. This is still the march on their way to Bataan, where you said 100,000. My God, look at this death. It's
appalling. And those
appalling.
Who, they even killed those who were surrendering. There was a company who surrendered late in Bataan, and they were actually brutally killed, bayoneted to death by the Japanese for surrendering late. Mm-hmm. So the Japanese actually did not respect people who surrendered. Because of the Bushido, code of Bushido, they don't like people who surrender.
Annihilate, ano?
They look down upon people who surrender.
What building, what structure is this that we are seeing now? Parang Santo Tomas, ano?
Actually, this is in Australia already.
Ah, outside nito, Australia. So
the
MacArthur left.
The government, this is Washington.
Washington again, yes, the White House.
And MacArthur was pleading the American government to help us. Because the Americans were concentrated on the European front.
Yes,
and they left us actually. We were the second choice.
This was for a period of about 3 years.
Yes.
Correct? Bonnie, about three years. This is what you call the Japanese occupation. Now, who's this speaking? Is that Roosevelt?
I think so.
Okay, speaking to the U.S. Congress in America. You'll notice a lot of these pictures, ladies and gentlemen, that you are seeing, as much as this is dated back some 60 years ago, there is a parallel on very much the same way that things do happen today. Here we go. Now, when we talk of devastation, Bonnie, yung nangyari sa Pilipino, yung nakita natin, yung nawasak ng Manila, and everything was taken apart. How do you feel, in your reference, does this affect a modern-day Filipino? For example, the different cultures. Let's take the perception of corruption. How? How does that... Because we were corrupted during that period? Through how? Corroboration?
Actually, corruption was... Here, even before the Spaniards arrived, even during the Spanish times.
So corrupt talaga Pilipino?
There was corruption already in a small scale, but the culture was different. I mean, per se, the air, no, the atmosphere was different. There were actually people who were afraid to violate the law. They were freedom-loving, they were patriotic, and they were the social pressure. They behaved more because of the social pressure rather than religion.
Okay, so what's happened is because the way we reacted towards our history, it brings us, there's a parallelism of the way we are today. How about the indolence of the Filipino?
Indolence could be traced, there are many...
Not the war.
It was part of, because of our weather, they said, our climate.
Ah, sa init lang.
And because it's humid. It's, okay. We are not actually aware of this until we go abroad. And we see what is humidity. We feel what is humidity and humidity here, which is very high.
Yeah, it's very, very high. It's malagkit.
Okay, and the other is political. I think some people say, psychologists say, we actually violated the law. We asked out protests because they were colonizers. We did not like to follow the law as a sign of our patriotism to get away with it. Makalusot. Yung word palusot.
Okay. So doon nag-umpisa na yun.
some social psychologists say that it's common among countries that were conquered.
Yung palusot.
Because they don't like, during the Japanese period, people did not like to bow to the Japanese. As much as possible, they would avoid the long cut rather than bow. You know, the Japanese bow, it's not only like that. It's body, you bend the whole body like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, proper.
And you will be slapped. You know, they slap, you know,
they just whack you, your whole face
goes the other turns around. And people did not like that. So even those who would bow would even say, Ohio, instead of saying Ohio.
And they would, Ohio.
And they would even say, you know, that nasty word, the sign of a black, that. Mm-mm, but they were there bowing the Japanese.
So there was resilience, there was still an effort, there was still fighting going on. There was still the rebel part of the Philippines. Tell me, how can you relate today's ills with yesterday's experience?
Well, we can trace it during the looting of Manila. People learned how to steal, and it was justifiable because the Americans opened the port so that the Japanese will not take advantage of the stockpile of goods, including...
So to protect your goods?
So they if they could not destroy it, they destroyed their... their fuel depot in Pandacan, they burned that, they exploded.
Burned it, yeah.
And the goods was open. The port of Manila was open to public. Looting took place.
Naku, nagwala na.
Oh. After this, not only that, is that hindi lang yung port, Manila port, pati including stores that were outside the
they
port of Manila.
They were all looted na.
They were also being looted. And the people in Manila were saying, come on, the Japanese, they were wishing the Japanese to arrive so that peace and order will...
Baliktad.
Oh yeah, the people dead.
Baliktad.
And even the war, people became selfish because of self-preservation. They would
even... But you can't help that, Laman. Yes. That's normal. It's a normal trait. Survival of...
The fittest.
Basically, the fittest. Yeah.
And people learned about it. And even during the liberation of Manila, some people looted the properties that were spared off from the fire in Ermita. And you know that the... one of the survivors is Lourdes Reyes Montinola, the chairperson of FEU. She's the survivor, the lone survivor of the family in Agno Street in Malate.
Agno, that's behind La Salle.
Yes. You know, her parents were still dying because they were bayoneted by the Japanese in their residence, no? And she was pleading. People came to her house and ignored and looted her house. Just imagine that.
Ninakawan pa, no?
So we call it, the people were desensitized,
naging manhid.
During the war. Because if you were crossing Manila and bullets were flying all over, if you escape the Japanese massacre, you'll be hit by the American mortars. So people were running in the street. Some, you will see your relatives dying, being killed. And what do you feel? He said, nothing. I asked somebody, he said, oh, nothing. Lucky it's not me.
My God. Do you think that has anything to do with the non-rebellious nature or the non-confrontational nature of the Filipino against fighting his very own? You know, that's been up for conversation so many times in discussion. Lagay mo Pilipino, magpipinsan, magkakaharapan. Alam mo, hindi pwede mangyayari ang civil war dito sa atin, miski na mangyayari. Ergo, EDSA 1, EDSA 2. There's just no way. Do you think that has something to do with that?
Actually,
psychologically?
Meaning, magpinsan, they cannot go.
No, or I mean, Filipino. I mean, magkakatugo. I mean, can we actually envision the Filipino nation, the people, going at arms or at odds against each other like a civil war?
That's possible.
Is it really?
Yes.
Because some people are saying that would be the only way out or the solution to the endless corruption. And not corruption of just government people or local governance. It's basically of the people as a whole. Well, some politicians say that's one way out of it. And some doomsayers. I personally am totally against it. And I like to believe mahirap, no? But I saw how EDSA worked out. Hindi kaya tirahin.
We actually basic. We are a very gentle people, according to Father Reuter, James Reuter, in his play, The Gentle People. Actually, it's seen in our literature. We lack catharsis, according to my professor, Isagani Cruz. Dr. Isagani Cruz.
He's your professor.
Yeah.
Okay.
And even in the Rizal's two novels, it lacks catharsis.
Okay.
There's no high chung.
Walang high chung, walang point of explosion.
People who just get away with it, they were not punished severely. And we have seen that in EDSA. Just Marcos walk away. He flew, they escaped. Mm. If that wouldn't happen in South America, in other countries.
Barilan yung patayan yan.
That it's innate in us, we like peace, actually. Naawa tayo. I think because of our religion, madali tayong maawa. Kawawa naman si ganito.
How about where we are today because of what happened some 50, 60 years ago with the destruction of Metro Manila? Basically, any relationship there or we have just evolved into what we are? Today, we experience all sorts of issues, whether it be in agriculture and rice, industrialization, the ill effects, mining, and even basic legislation and where we're at. Is there any interrelationship you feel to the way the Filipino has become what he has been because of what he was? For example, the devastation, the bloody liberalization, not liberalization, the freedom that was given to them, which cost them a lot of blood and death and destruction.
During the bloody liberation of Manila.
Liberation, my gosh, yeah. Liberalization. Masyado na ako nagpo-politiko eh.
A lot of our people who were leaders in the fields of science, politics, in literature and everything, they were killed, if not displaced, during and after the war.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's like being actually Manila, I could say it's like a basketball team, Team A, that suffered a plane crash or all of them were killed. Mm-hmm. And so the team B or the team C was not prepared to take that place.
Take over.
And they did not have models. They lack enough models in the field of education, in politics especially.
But our leaders of late or of the last 60 years, the August halls of Congress, I mean, I've heard a lot of the oratorical speeches, and a lot of them were actually seeming to be great wise senators and all. What happened? Naiba?
Most of them were lawyers. No? Some people would take up law or anything just to become a politician. I remember that. Why are you taking up law? Because I want to run for Congress. I want to be a senator. I want to be a president. Now I think it's not no longer a prerequisite.
No more. I don't think even finishing high school, as proven, is a prerequisite to becoming the president of the country.
I think this is after effect. People, I think, I might be wrong, psychology. People, it's a sign of protest that people are electing officials whom they know are not capable of running the government, but they are just famous in the field of
whatever
field in sports or
no. But let's face it, Bunny. Most politicians that win today and they say feudalism, family oligarchs and whatnot. Come on, let's face it. It takes money because the people accept money. You know, to vote for you. So it's really the fault of the many, and the democracy is the rule of the many or the majority. And they're accepting the money, they're being bribed. Alam mo naman kung tatakbo ka ng election, kaya sinasabi nila pera. Miski sila, they're disgusted, but how else?
Actually, it's a carryover during the Quezon era. Actually, during the time, after our government, I see to it that I think this kind of government we adopted from the Americans is not fitted for us. Our culture.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, before the time, during the election.
Interesting, Boy Saicon says the same thing.
During the time of Quezon and before Quezon, those elections for Congress, the people who were rich ran for politics, and they even actually, some of them lost their business for spending in politics.
Why? For social responsibility in response to this community? Or ego? No.
I cannot say. Maybe it's ego, part of ego, want to serve the country.
Or real service to country.
And the other is, now that's the start when the politicians approach now the hacenderos, the landlords,
yes.
They would approach them so that they will influence the vote.
So ganun din yun, like what you're doing now.
Yeah, actually, there's a politician now in the Senate whose father was actually a feudal lord in somewhere in the south. But they would approach because the people naman noon, sabi ng mother ko, they would even ask, they were innocent, naive, and they respected the rich as educated people, and they said, Señor, Señora, we don't know whom to vote. Please tell us whom to vote. They're innocent. So they voted the person whom was recommended by their landlords.
So the landlord was what you do favors for the landlord, or you lobby towards their interest, and the landlords would see to it because they have the volume of employees to put you into position.
Yes.
So it's a way of the problem with the vote system today. Nevertheless, it's still the rule of the majority, and that's
from
democracy.
That time on, our democracy was represented by the social and economically elite people, not represented well by the likes of the Filipino people.
So it's still very much the same today?
Yes. There are only few who are poor who ran and they won. It's a very, the minority. And they are the sincere ones, actually, I should say.
Well, we can tell that Bonnie has not lost his faith to the Filipino people. So,
even cheating during that time. They were cheating, cases of cheating in the election. My mother used to tell me that his father had to stay awake all that in the precinct because they had to check that it was not cheated. You know how they cheated? They would have a tobacco,
yeah,
and they would stain the ballot.
Okay.
And once that is stained, it's nullified.
Nullified.
And pati yung coded ba yung babayaran ka, the landlord will say, vote this one. And he would know who did not vote whom. Because they were already coded. If you place, for example, De La Cruz as number one, Santiago number two,
correct.
Santos, they would know if you voted, they followed or not. And watch out.
Grabe,
so that
no?
started
so,
this.
So, palang meron na rin. Pareho na rin.
Actually, that became perfect, worse during the time of President Quirino, during his re-election. And also, I should say, during the time of Marcos, his re-election in 1969, that was horrible. The padding of votes, and especially that snap election against Cory Aquino, in which they they used the computer to multiply the barangays and everything. That